All right, we are back. Welcome to Computer Science E-75. This is Lecture 2, PHP Continued. So we've got a lot of fun stuff in store tonight in more ways than one. But before you know what's up for this evening, let's take a quick look back at these things called forms. So up until now, Project Zero has been entirely static. It was meant to level the playing field, give you a bit of practice or a bit more experience with XHTML, CSS, and the like, but we immediately, with Project 1, dive into dynamic websites. So how do we get the dynamism? Well, first and foremost, perhaps, by taking user input. So you might have noticed over the weekend that we turned on this fairly simple form mechanism on the side of the page that was meant to be both pedagogical in nature and also hopefully useful over time to come. So each of these websites, Apache's documentation, MySQL's documentation, as we'll see, PHP's documentation, all fortunately have a search feature. And we thought, well, here's an interesting opportunity for some dynamism. Why not try to centralize students' ability to search these various manuals? And so how did we do this? Well, I knew that Apache's manual is located at, actually, let's take PHP instead. PHP's manual is located, recall, at php.net. So I took a look at the form field up there, search for, and that was an input type equals text. I then looked at the source code for this page, and what XHTML element was I looking for, most likely, if I wanted to sort of mimic that interface but put it on our own site. Yeah, so that form element, and I needed to know the action line, I needed to know the method, whether get or post, and then what else did I need to know from underneath the hood here? If I wanted to, again, recreate the search functionality on our own site, much like we did with Google last week. Yeah, so the input names or the field names, like is that thing called Q, like I think it was for Google? Is it called search box, whatever? So I needed to look at the source code. And all of you presumably know you can right click a page or go to some menu option and just look at the source code. Wonderful learning tool. And certainly if you actually want to implement someone's functionality, we can learn from that. So I myself created a form here, presumably. But I needed to do a bit of cleverness, at least if I wanted to do this the quick and dirty way. And I actually ended up using a bit of JavaScript, which is one of the languages we will get to in this course. So I won't dwell on this example today. But let's take a look underneath the hood for a moment at how we implemented this four-way search feature, whereby if I wanted to search for the PHP function called stir to lower, which is a function that takes a string and forces it to lowercase. I know that it exists, but I don't remember what the usage is. What does it return? What does it take? Well, notice that one little clever trick is it's PHP's manual that we hypothesize you'll be using more than any of the others. So you hit enter, and by default, that goes ahead and submits via get or post. Get to PHP site, a Q equals stir to lower, and we've just sort of mimicked their search functionality. There's really no magic here, but this was sort of an example, a learning exercise even for us, in how can we take four different sites and sort of reproduce their functionality simply by inferring how they work from their source code. And now I'll explain for a moment that error we saw a moment ago. If I get lazy and don't type anything in and just click PHP, it's not really my error, although arguably I could check for null input, but I would wager that this is actually a not very good design, because apparently this suggests that even on PHP's site, if you just search for nothing, you get back internal error, please try later, which really isn't the appropriate error message. So you'll see as you work through these projects that we will often expect rigorous error handling and also reasonable functionality or some such wording. And by that we mean inappropriate error messages that explain the wrong problem are incorrect, shall we say. And these are the kinds of things we're going to be expecting folks to be checking for, because at the end of the day, building good websites and robust websites certainly involves a great amount of error checking, which it seems that PHP.net is not doing. Now, maybe it doesn't happen that way if I actually use their interface, because they don't really care if David's implementation of PHP.net works or not. But certainly for our own sites, it becomes more interesting. Let's just take a quick look underneath the hood. We can come back to this come JavaScript time. So you'll notice that, and I'm going to pull it up in this editor so that the font is a little bigger, but I'll explain where these files are in just a bit. I believe this is in a file called begin.php. I'm going to look for my own form element. And here it is. It's a little messy today, only because I've got a rather big font here, but it looks like the default action for that form goes to where? And this form begins toward the top of my window here. Yeah, so by default, I said that it's going to go to php.net, and that's why when you hit enter, it goes there. But then notice, and again, it's a little messy for today, so we'll just wave our hands a bit. There appear to be 1, 2, 3, and if I scroll down, maybe a fourth input option. So it turns out, if you've not used it before, there's not just input type equals text, password, submit. There's also input type equals button. And what you can do with buttons specifically, which look just like submit buttons, but you can add handlers to them, which is largely their purpose. Notice that one of the things we'll be seeing in the weeks to come are little tricks like this. So this is an input type equals type equals, oops, I lied, type equals button. So it looks like what's happening with this input is that on click, this is an event handler, as we'll see in a few weeks, and it's a little purple now, but you can take a look at home again if you'd like. On click, the Windows location should become the following string, HTTP, and then this whole thing, dev.mysql.com, which is something I copy-pasted from MySQL's source code, their website. I figured out that it goes to search.php, their own search box. I realized that I need to tell it what version I want to search for the manual. And then it turns out that their query string, their parameter, is also called Q. So I just say equals, close quote, and then I append to it, JavaScript will see, plus, much like Java, is the concatenation operator. I'm going to append the value of the document's search field, its Q field, value. Okay, so that's a big mouthful for now. But suffice it to say for tonight's purposes that all that's doing is taking that hard-coded MySQL string that ends in Q equals and appending what to it, presumably? The search string that I called Q in my own form. And then what's happening is because I began this string with window.location equals, I'm just changing the Windows location, thereby inducing an HTTP GET. Okay, so this isn't terribly dynamic, because even here, I'm just sort of stealing the work of others, like we did with Google and we did with CNN. But tonight, we're actually going to begin implementing the code underneath the hood that actually receives this form input. And here on after, we're no longer going to punt and just ship that data off to someone else, but actually begin implementing our own forms. So with that said, one of the first things I did back in college when I was teaching myself some web-based programming, and in that time Perl was very much in vogue, I was a member of, I helped organize the freshman intramural sports program, which was casually called Frosh IMs. And this was back in, what, 95? Well, back in 95, when I was a kid, we used to register for sports by filling out a piece of paper and walking halfway across Harvard Yard and sliding it into the mailbox of one of the RAs on campus. And then they would do their thing. Well, this seemed, even to me, a sort of aspiring computer scientist at the time, if not overzealous freshman, a perfect opportunity for computers to get involved. So we wanted to have a website that would take students' names, maybe a checkbox if they wanted to nominate themselves as a captain, gender was useful for various sports, and also what dorm they came from. So probably by now you know, or could certainly go figure out how to implement this XHTML. It's a fairly simple web form, and this is just the aesthetic. This is just the visualization of some of the XHTML code that we've enumerated the past couple of lectures. The input type equals text, input type equals radio, and so forth. So if you're not familiar with these things and really had no cause to be for Project Zero, with Project One you'll very quickly get acclimated to these things. But what's interesting tonight is what we're going to do with this data. So let's do take a quick look at where the action line is for this thing. So I'm going to become Malin, so I can get into Malin Rouge here for a second. And I'm going to go into this directory. And I'll make the code that we end up using tonight available online after class by tomorrow, if you'd like to take a look or make tweaks to it. But this is register.html. So it's a fairly simple page. I ended up using sort of in old school fashion, a little invisible table, which some folks have religious objections to, which just happens to have a border equals zero, and that's fine. I won't get into the religious debate tonight over it, but frankly, it's nice and easy to lay out structures like this, so I went with it for this. But what's interesting to us right now is where is this thing going? Well, the action line up until now has been going to google.com and a moment ago to MySQL and php.net. Well, now I'm going to take ownership of this data and actually process it myself and write my first real PHP processor here. So I am arbitrarily going to submit, have this form get submitted to register.php. And arbitrarily, I'm going to use method equals post so that nothing ends up in the URL for privacy or whatever reasons. So what might register.php look like? Well, first of all, realize that I didn't put all that much time into this. So I'm going to make myself a captain, check that. And I'll say I was in Matthews, and I'm going to register. All right. So that's the end game here, right? Tonight, you're going to walk away with the knowledge of how to make that dynamism. So what's going on underneath the hood? Well, this simple example is actually pretty representative of a pretty reasonable structure for a web for a PHP program. So the goal at hand is simply to put together some XHTML that takes user input and submits it to a PHP file that does something with that input. Now, obviously, it doesn't do all that much, but let's see what is indeed going on behind the scenes. So this is register.php. And you can already tell that most of it appears to be just XHTML. And herein lies that that meshing, that this inherent relationship between XHTML and PHP. You tend to find a lot of one inside of the other, because that's really what this language was deployed for. But a typical paradigm for receiving user input from a PHP file is to, one, begin the file with open bracket question mark. So here comes some PHP code so that it actually gets executed by the server and not just passed through raw like all of this stuff would. All right, and up there, what I want to do is check the value of three variables. So we said briefly last week that you get sort of automagically for yourself, whenever implementing a PHP-based website, a few different super global variables. So dollar sign always demarks a variable in PHP. Underscore all caps post represents an associative array, a hash table, if you will, that contains any and all of the name value pairs that were submitted from some form via post to this particular file. So unlike the days of Perl, where you actually had to sort of parse that long get string yourself or use CGI.pm, a Perl module, or God forbid back in the days of C when you had to parse the thing with various string functions, PHP, upon receiving this form submission, does all that parsing of data for you and then inserts it into this array and then hands you this array. Yeah?
Is that code going to run the very first time that the page is opened?
Indeed. This code will run the very first time the page is opened.
So will it produce that error because those checks will fail?
A good question. So will it fail? Let me come back to that in just a moment and just consider for a moment the fairly simple logic here. So I'm saying in my PHP comment, incidentally PHP, you can do // for inline comments or /*, like C or C++ comments. So if posts, if the key called name inside of the post associative array equals the empty string, or gender is nothing, or dorm is nothing, what am I clearly doing? All right, so I'm just doing a redirect to my error page. Now, this is a bit of a weird line, but recall our discussion of HTTP headers. One of the means by which, one of the ways that you can send a user from one page to another is by issuing one of those location headers, either a location with a return code of 301 or 302. Recall our brief discussion last week when we sniffed some Firefox traffic? Well, if I want to redirect the user, it really is as simple as sending out an HTTP header using PHP's header function, and then specify what the line is and give a fully qualified URL. So what's going to happen then in this case if gender, dorm, or name are null, are empty? Well, let's try. I refreshed my page to clear my input, and I'm going to go ahead and click register, and I did not register properly. Well, why is that? Well, what's the URL, even though it's a bit small? We obviously got redirected to that page, and I will tease you with this, and I'll leave it to you to infer what that page.html file actually looks like. There's really not all that magic there. All right, but let's go back to this. And if I do actually fill this thing out correctly, captain's apparently not required, but I can type in this stuff and register. Well, now I'm in fact registered successfully. So you ask the question, what if we just pull up this page? Well, to be clear, what's this file called? So this is register.php. So technically, there's nothing stopping a user from just pulling up this URL, opening a brand new browser window, and clicking enter. Well, you did not register properly. Now, we could detect this if we really wanted to, right? Logically, how can you detect if the user has tried to visit this page directly, most likely? So you can check for the HTTP refer header. In other words, one of the HTTP headers that's often, but not necessarily, sent by a browser is the URL from which a user came. It's actually not a terribly, it's not a guaranteed reliable mechanism, because some browsers, especially for privacy reasons, don't have to send that. So you can actually, because we know we're using post, we can do another check altogether. So if the method isn't post, so we can check then really for just the contents. If are there any contents in this post array, right? And effectively this boils down to the same thing, right? If there's no name, if there's no dorm, if there's no gender, then either the user just got lazy and didn't input anything at all, or maybe they pulled up this page directly. And in either case, we might as well just spit out an error message. But there's many different ways we could respond to the user, and we'll tease those apart in a moment. But just a comment on this overall approach. You will see in a lot of PHP products out there that people will spit out the location header followed by just a file name. So that's technically not correct. And you should always put a full URL, even though it's nice if I could just have said location colon error.html. So just FYI, because that's a common mistake. And some browsers, though, reasonably might break, though realistically most do not. But there's still some there's stuff going on down here. So under what circumstances do we actually reach this XHTML? So if does not evaluate to true, in which case we don't issue that header, in which case we don't exit, which means we just fall through to whatever else is in the file. And per our chat last week, anything that's not betwixt that open bracket question mark and question mark close bracket is just going to be spit out raw by the web server. And so what the user actually sees then is an error page, like is an informative registration page. And it's down here where we see, ah, aha, you were in fact registered. Yeah? So sure. So to be more specific, can you detect if the user submitted the form or not? So this way, I sort of waved my hands at that and said, well, this is sort of equivalent, because if none of those fields are present, then functionally it doesn't matter if they just pulled it up directly or just submitted an empty form. It's still an error. But because $_post is an associative array, what we can actually do, and this is, again, perhaps the only use for WordPad on a Windows machine, big fonts sometimes. Because this is an associative array, we can actually do some interesting things here. And you'll see in PHP, as I think I gave the URL last week, there's a whole bunch of array functions. In fact, why don't we use our fancy new search feature, search for array on php.net. Let's go to the first link there. And this is the chapter that I think we did provide the document, the URL for last week in one of the slides. There's a whole bunch of array functions in PHP, probably more than you'll ever want. But they all begin with array for the most part, and then via this documentation, frankly, that'll tell you how it all works. But what I'm hinting at here is that if $_post is just an array, well, we can sort of infer if there was actually a form submission by just counting how many elements are in there. And it turns out, and this is one of the exceptions, count is a function in PHP that returns the size of an array. So if count equals 0, I could similarly assume nothing was actually submitted. So you'll find throughout this course, but really in PHP in general, there are many different ways to tackle these problems. And a lot of it many solutions just boil down to stylistic choices. So what we'll try to do from time to time is not only in lectures, but also in sections, where you get different perspectives, you'll see different tricks online. And so long as you appreciate your choices and understand the implications, then there are often many ways to do things. In fact, this is a bit of a hack, just checking equals, quote, unquote, because what is this not going to catch correctly? Spaces, right? It's not all that uncommon for a user, maybe accidentally, to have their web page up and, you know, they hit a space but they forgot to fill it in. Well, unfortunately now, if I were actually inserting this data into a database and the user did successfully provide a gender and a dorm, well, that appears to have been registered. So we need a bit more power here. Well, what else could we do? Well, first of all, We could check for this. That certainly solves that problem, but that's kind of an inane approach. So what else could we do here? What would be a better approach? Okay, so trimming inputs, especially when you're doing web development, is certainly a valuable thing. I can do this in a bunch of different ways. Sometimes if I don't really care about mutilating the data that was passed in, what I could just start off my PHP file with is just something like, let's just clobber the value in there with the result of trimming that value. And if I actually looked up, as you should become increasingly comfortable doing, the trim function via our little fancy interface, what you would see is that this function quite simply removes leading white space and trailing white space. And this is a good thing, especially when you're trying to normalize, as we'll see come SQL time, what's inside of your database. Odds are you don't want to be storing superfluous white space for space reasons, for string comparison reasons, and perhaps some other reasons as well. So trimming these values initially is certainly a useful thing. So we'll do that on gender. We'll do that on dorm. OK, so now this check would actually work. What you'll commonly see, though, PHP folks do is that that's a few two keystrokes too many. I could just do this, if not post bracket name. So if there's not a value called name in the post array, I mean, that's sort of equivalent, although there's a tiny corner case that this fails to handle properly. So whenever you just do not something, so that means that if the string inside of post bracket name is null, well, then we'll catch it, right? Because not null is true. But what if the user types in, remember, PHP is very loose with its type system. What if the user types in false, you know, false or zero, for better yet, zero for their name? So just appreciate, again, the implications. We could use str length. Just count the length of the string, and if after trimming we actually find multiple letters, multiple characters in there, string length is greater than zero, that would work as well. But something more powerful, as we'll see, especially when you're trying to take some interesting user data, is to actually use regular expressions. And those of you coming from other language backgrounds have probably used regular expressions before. If not, this might be a bit new. And this will be a very quick crash course on it, because it's sort of most fun to play around with these things sometimes on your own. But PHP, for those coming from a Perl background, implements the entirety of Perl's regular expressions. And if Perl is great at one thing in particular, it's pattern matching. And so PHP has adopted as one of its regular expression models everything that Perl can do. So what I could actually do, for instance, is something like this. So if preg match, Perl regular expression match, and now it takes two parameters, two arguments. One's going to go there, and one's going to be the value of the field, so post name. So if this matches a regular expression, well, again, there's different ways to do this, and we can spend more time on this in section, but between these two forward slashes, I need a regular expression. Now, for now, all I care about is that a user's name that is going to have to be, let's just say, alphabetical. So one way of doing this, but you'll know, you might know of many, is so long as it's a name comprised of A through Z or capital A through capital Z, let's say zero or more times, just to keep things simple, well, this whole expression is going to evaluate to true. Okay, and I won't dwell too long tonight on what regular expressions are, but all this is saying, again, to be clear, is if that pattern, the first argument, matches the second argument, go ahead and return true. And this is a powerful mechanism, because more than just pattern matching on names, what's a perfect type of user input that you really want to do some form of validation of, perhaps? Like an email address, right? So you can imagine being a little more, this example being a little more compelling if the user actually had submitted a field called email. Right, just another text field instead of name, we'll call it email. Well, this thing, and again, we can be really anal and go to like the RFC that defines what an email address is, or I can just sort of guess at it here. So an email address is going to be any of those things, or 0 through 9, or an underscore. That's all. And OK, fine. And a hyphen. After the Z. OK, so it's going to be that, followed by an at sign, followed by, and I promise you there are easier ways to do this, although for a true email address, it does get messy pretty quickly. So more of that, followed by a dot, followed by, you know what, I'm going to get really lazy here and just say .coms is all we're going to allow. But the point I'm trying to communicate is just the general idea here, and we'll refer to one of the online references for those of you coming to the course without a background in regular expressions from some other language. PHP makes it very possible, if not, once you're familiar, easy to actually check, perform checks against the types of strings that are being submitted. So when you're trying to validate against phone numbers, against email addresses, and just do some kinds of sanity checks before you actually register that user or try to process their credit card payment, you can do so with these things called regular expressions. In fact, it always amazes me when I come across a commercial website where they tell you parenthetically in the next to the field where they ask for your phone number, you know, omit hyphens or, you know, omit parentheses. Like, why? Like, they could do that for me and accept most any format of a number, right? You can just take a 10-digit number. Who cares if it has parentheses or hyphens, because there exist PHP functions in the string, among the string functions, that can just get rid of hyphens and can get rid of parentheses. In fact, case in point, I thank a subset of you all again for yelling at us in your surveys and writing your FAS usernames in all caps and your domain names in all caps and your addresses with and without commas, a complete mess. But fortunately, we're pretty good with regular expressions, and we're good with functions like stir to lower, and we can just force all those obnoxious domain names to lowercase in our own database. And PHP makes this kind of stuff very easy. So what you'll see in sections and also is in the projects to come is some of these utility functions. But for tonight's purposes, this is meant to be an overview of that kind of stuff. So let's forge ahead for a moment, and what we'll actually do is come back to other sort of paradigms for taking inputs from user and then processing it, because this is not a very good model, right? What this model suggests that I have three different pages implementing a module, so to speak. One presents the data, one processes that data, and maybe gives an informative success message. But if there's an error, remember that the user gets sent where? So you get a third page, error.html. And in fact, that is the most infuriating type of dynamic website, right? Where they do some error checking, and then they present you with an error page saying, sorry, that username's in use already, or your password's too weak. Hit your browser's back button. And what almost always happens when you hit a browser's back button? The whole damn form like goes empty, and you have to start all over again. This happened to me just yesterday when I was trying to register for a conference, like infuriating, a computer science conference, ironically. So anyhow, much better would it be is if we could maybe not redirect the user submission, direct the user submission from one page to another, but maybe ideal would be to have a page that submits to it itself, so that same page then can repopulate the field, so to speak. And we'll take a look at an example of that in just a moment. So here is a quick cheat sheet of sorts for regular expressions, but I would refer you to any previous course or most any online Google regular expression tutorial, and you'll be inundated with wonderful examples. And so I think this is the sort of topic, if you don't know it, you can really learn on demand. But what's really neat too, in Perl and in PHP as well, not only can you check strings against patterns, you can also do pattern matching. So one of the other things I'm quite proud to say is a lot of you, when asked for your FAS usernames, gave us something at fas.harvard.edu. But we're trying to get your username into our database, not your email address. Or some of you, and maybe I shouldn't be picking on our students like this, but when we ask you for your domain name and parenthetically, don't forget the TLD, forgot the TLD. So we just assume those of you who did this meant .com, so we just appended that. If we detected with a little regular expression, if there's no match against .com or .net or .org or the like, go ahead and just assume they meant .com. So long story short, there's a lot of power here, and we used a lot of it this past week. So here's a dynamic website, and we hope to continue making it more dynamic. And this is perhaps the extent of my artistic ability, so I hope we have neatness satisfied, if not necessarily a work of art. But let's take a look at just how some parts of the course's website are working for a couple of reasons. One, what we've tried to do in implementing the website is to use it really as a teaching tool. And I'll make some of the source code available to various pages after tonight, especially the ones we look at. And presumably a website that you're using quite often is a useful way to sort of translate concepts to actual incarnations when you can actually play around with the page. So How is the main index page of this site being driven? Well, let me go ahead and go into the CS75 site. And I'm going to go into our public HTML. You'll see that we've got a whole bunch of folders in there. And this is not going to be a tour of the entire website. We'll just pluck off some interesting features tonight. But let's go ahead into index.php. Much like index.html is often the default page in the HTML world, in PHP, it's often index.php. Well, there it is. That's it. Now, granted, it's scrolling, so it's not all that impressive. But actually, maybe we can impress you if I just briefly change the fonts here to actually fit everything on the window. OK, that's our homepage. OK, cryptic maybe, and maybe not fundamentally all that interesting, but it seems pretty darn short to be implementing much of what our website appears to be doing. So that's it. So one of the approaches that we've taken with the courses website is to implement a sort of templating system of sorts. And you can Google PHP template systems, and there's many, many, many options out there, almost as many bulletin board software packages as we allude to in Project 1 spec. They all have their merits and such, but this is not a hard feature to grow ourselves, so to speak. Right? For various reasons, we decided that it's nice functionally, aesthetically, if we just standardize the look of the website across every page, such that this stuff stays the same, this stuff structurally stays the same, but automatically updates itself with Ajax, as we'll get to in the course. The menu bar stays the same, but it's this stuff right in here that actually changes in this big box. So what we simply did was we sat down with some Photoshop, and we sat down with the text editor, and we made a basic website layout, and then we chopped it in two pieces. If you look at the source code, you'll see a combination of tables, I know, divs and such, that collectively make up this website. But somewhere in that page, there's a location where we can place all of this content. So what I did was I took all of the XHTML source code from that point up and put it into its own file called begin.php. I took all the XHTML below that point and put it in a file called end.php. And then I wrote some little PHP wrapper functions so that if I want to create a brand new web page on the course's website, all I have to do is something like this, new.php. I need to first, and let me make my font bigger again so that it's a little more viewable. The first thing I want to do is use a function called require once. And I want to require a file that I called course.php, which is in a subdirectory called includes. And then below that, I just need to call a function course begin. And then down here, I'm going to call course end. I'm going to save this file. It's called new.php, chmod at 600. And now I'm going to go back to our home page. Type in new.php, and voila, I have a brand new web page. And I call this a template approach because we really have a template. The whole website looks the same except for one piece of inner content. And arguably, it's nice and simple if making a new page, a new piece of content in your site, boils down to just calling these header functions and these footer functions. And then all of my content, as you might imagine, just goes here. Save that, reload, and there's my new web page. So what we'll try to do now for a little bit is tease apart some of what's going on underneath the hood here. For one, to sort of preach this model, where if you've gotten into the habit in the HTML world of taking a file like index.html and copying it and renaming it to page2.html and then renaming that to page3.html and having a lot of duplication of code, like that all should end today or soon. Right? Now, server-side includes is one way of dealing with this and sort of factoring out common code, but PHP too makes this all quite simple. So what is actually going on then inside of one of these pages? Well, let's take a look at one that's hopefully among the more useful ones. So this lectures page, like this. Similarly structured just like any of the others. Everything seems to follow a similar structure inside here. But it'd be kind of annoying, to me at least, if I had to, every time we had a lecture, go in and manually edit this page and copy and paste the previous lecture's content and then sort of update the links manually. I mean, much better is if I can just let a little program generate this sort of standardized interface and factor out the data from the presentation details. And this is sort of another overarching principle that tends to become increasingly useful and compelling the more complicated your sites get. So for personal home pages, probably don't need to put that much thought into this. But when you start designing a site that makes database calls and that you want to be fairly easily maintainable, it's quite useful if you can begin to separate your content from your aesthetics, from the presentation thereof. Now, what do I mean by content? I mean the fact that we have a handout called slides, and it's of type PDF. Like, that is content. That's real data. What's metadata is the fact that there's an ahref around the PDF label, the fact that there's an indentation here of like 15 pixels. All of that is aesthetic. So the approach we chose to take was to represent all of this data in a file called lectures.xml. Now, to be sure, this seems the perfect candidate for a database, right? If you want to just store all of this stuff, store all of your data somewhere, why not put it in a database? Well, there's a lot of overhead to storing stuff in a database. Not so much performance, but I mean administratively. Like, I don't particularly want to execute SQL commands every time I want to update the website. And I don't particularly want to pull up a GUI that allows me to insert a new row into a database. I mean, that just feels like it's defeating the point of making this process easy. I kind of like the fact that I can use Emacs or Vim or even Notepad, just open this text file, make a couple of changes, save, and update the course's website. So for instance, let's scroll down to the part of the file that describes tonight. Okay, it seems that not much has happened tonight. In fact, suppose I made a huge gaffe in today's lecture slides, which are apparently called slides. The file is called lecture2.pdf, and the type or the label that I want to give it on the site is called PDF. Well, you know what? Forget it. Well, you're not going to see this thing again. Reload the page, and now it's gone simply by having modified what effectively is a configuration file. Notice slides is still there. Well, that's because this tag is still there. Let me get rid of that thing too. Right, 2 seconds, a couple of commands, and now that's gone as well. Well, reverse the effect, and let's fast forward to what's going to happen tomorrow when we start posting the videos. Well, the videos, when they get posted, let's see, it's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 of these things. So let me copy that, scroll down to here, paste this in. And I'm going quickly intentionally just to demonstrate that tomorrow when it's time to start posting videos, there they are. So using XML or using CSV, comma separated variables files, is a very compelling choice for a lot of contexts where you just want to either configure an application or you just need a quick and dirty database, a poor man's database, so to speak, whereby you're just using a flat ASCII file to store your data. And that's precisely what we'll actually use in Project 1. Well, what's going on here? Well, in addition to focusing on PHP tonight, I thought we'd introduce a couple of basic tenets of this world of XML. So out of curiosity, how many of you have ever used XPath before? Okay, so a few of you. So in a few minutes' time, all of you will have seen XPath, and in a few weeks' time, all of you will have used XPath because it's a wonderfully simple yet powerful query language for XML documents. Now, fortunately, I don't think we have to spend all that much time on XML because you all have used it, right? XHTML, even though there are very specific meanings assigned to like open bracket strong and open bracket body, the X in XHTML means it's an XML document. So an XML document is just a text document that's got a whole bunch of tags, elements more properly, one of which has a start tag, one of which has an end tag. Everything's got to be symmetric. You open it, the first one you open has to be the last one you close. If you have attribute value pairs, all those values have to be quoted, recall, in single quotes or double quotes. So that conversation's the same. But XML, if you've never written it yourself, is sort of like XHTML, but you can make up your own tag names and make up your own attribute names just based on the goal at hand. Well, the goal at hand for us 3 weeks ago was to come up with a representation of lectures in this XML format. Arguably, we could have chosen less verbose words just to save on disk space, but it's just a text file, so we didn't really care, and this is quite straightforward to us, especially someone who doesn't know much about databases. So this is an excerpt from the file we just looked at, because I arbitrarily, but hopefully fairly reasonably, decided that I would represent each lecture with a lecture tag. And I would assign an attribute called number, inside of which would be the number, so that I could automatically generate that label on the website. And every lecture I arbitrarily decided is going to have a child, so to speak, called title, another called dates, and then another potentially big one called resources. And inside of resources would be zero or more resource elements. each resource is going to have a name in the form of an attribute. And each resource is going to have zero or more formats assigned to it. Because recall that the way we decided, for our own personal aesthetic reasons, to structure the site is that if there are different formats that some resource comes in, like a video, well, we didn't want to just list four different times, video, 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 but rather video, and here's your four different formats. And so that's why we structured the data as such, so we could capture that semantically, the different types of formats. Well, notice that every resource that's being opened is eventually being closed after we provide those formats, and I decided that I'd call one attribute path, and that equals either a file name locally or a URL. In fact, I wanted to be clever and flexible so that if I ever show like supernews.mailinrouge.com, I'd like to be able to just paste in a URL and not just the index.html file of a website. So what I actually check, in, as we'll see in a moment, in the PHP file that reads this data is I check if the path attribute begins with slash, assume it's on the local system. If it begins with nothing, assume it's also local and relative to the current directory. And if it begins with http://, assume that it's actually a URL and display it, if necessary, accordingly. So long story short, it's not terribly interesting that we chose this file format, but that we could choose this format. And infinitely many other designs were possible, but this one has proved pretty quick and dirty, but straightforward to us. Yeah. Using an equal sign. What's wrong with
equal quote should be labeled equals quote globally.
Resource
equal
format
equals
label.
In the
format
that
equal sign
everywhere you see the word label, it should be an equal sign between that and the
location. Oh damn it. Yes, quite true. I see what you're saying. This was a problem that I fixed in the website, actually, when I realized that I broke it. Watch this. Here's how you fix an XML file. Label equals. So you load up PowerPoint, you paste it in, and then you use their new fancy replace feature. Okay, thank you for catching that. Okay, so that was indeed not well formed. This now is update your mental notes or your paper notes accordingly. So what actually processes this file? Because at the end of the day, that's what's more interesting here. So let's go ahead and go into the public HTML lectures directory, and all that drives that big lectures page is this one file. All right, and this code too I'll make available later tonight. But what's really nice about PHP, PHP 5 at least, is that there's this class of functions called simple XML. And simple XML actually makes the manipulation and the traversal of XML data very easily, very easy. And you can even use these things called XPath functions, which we'll also take a look at tonight. So notice again, because of the way we've structured our website, the very first line needs to require that file. That's the equivalent of sharp include or import, depending on what language background you're coming from. And in that file, as we'll eventually see, are a whole bunch of helper functions and other useful tricks that sort of drive the website overall. So the next line of code there is to say a variable called XML equals the return value of that function call there. And it's a little cryptic, but all that's doing is it is calling a function called file get contents, which is being passed one argument. I actually used a constant here, but let me make it look simpler for discussion purposes. I'm saying get the contents of lectures.xml, pass it to this constructor, those of you with an object-oriented background, called simple XML element, and return a variable. Now, what is that doing? Well, this class, simple XML element, is going to read that entire file into memory, and it's going to represent it with a tree of sorts in memory, specifically an object. What does this object look like? Well, let's go to the lectures page, and now, unbeknownst to those who might be pulling up the website at home, let me go ahead and break this. So first, just for debugging purposes, I'm going to print out completely invalidly a pre-tag, which means pre-formatted in HTML. Then I'm going to use that recursive print function that we saw briefly last week to print out whatever is inside of this XML file. And actually, I need to roll back so that the file name is not butchered. Okay, so print recursively the contents of XML, and then I'm going to exit. I don't even want to bother doing anything with this data. Let's just take a look. So I'm going to go back to the website, reload, And now what you see is a somewhat cryptic but fully complete description of what is inside that variable called $XML. Now, fortunately, you don't really have to know this exact structure to navigate it, because again, it's a simple API, and the documentation makes clear how you can sort of walk from child to child to child in this document. But notice that embodied in there, apparently, is all of the data that was in that file. Okay, so tuck that away for a moment, because you don't necessarily have to rely on that to do useful things. Let's go back to the way things were, scroll down. Well, here's just some XHTML that's spitting out the title of the page. Right, if you don't believe me, yes, really. Go back and reload the page. And yes, in fact, that's the current page at hand. Now here's just some descriptive text. Let me save this before I forget all these changes we've made. All right, so now let's scroll down. And let me make the font slightly smaller so we can discuss a little more at once. Okay, so what's really nice, too small and back or okay? Okay. So ignore for the moment the XHTML, because that's really just an aesthetic detail, because there's not all that much PHP code going on here. Notice the very first useful line of code in this file is this one, for each lecture as lecture. So this for each construct, which I alluded to briefly last week, is a mechanism by which you can take an array and then iterate over each of its elements, and on each iteration assign the current element, whatever that variable is called. So lecture. So rather than write, for instance, lectures bracket I close bracket to sort of iterate with a number, you can iterate with this naming approach. So that implies that $XML hyphen bracket lecture is what data value? What type of value? So it's actually an array. So this is what the simple XML class does for you. If you want to get at all of the elements called lecture in that file that we just read in, what we can simply do is this. And I'll do it at the top again just so that we can see what's going on. I'm going to print out this pre-tag just to aesthetically make things nice. And now if I print recursively, not the whole XML element, but just let's say lecture, the element called lecture, and let's print out for just a moment. Okay? Because again, this is an array of all of the lecture elements in the document. So bracket 0 is the zeroth such element. So let's save that and reload. And it still looks similar to before, but the page is actually much smaller. There was much more content before, because now I'm only looking at the zeroth lecture. In fact, let's go one step further. Let's not look at the zeroth one, because that was kind of a big lecture. Let's look at the, so lecture 2. Well, now smaller. There's a lot less data there. And actually, there's still some data, because I apparently left the I copied and pasted stuff before. So let's see what next week's going to look like. The third lecture. Okay, there we go. Okay, there's really not all that much going on for the third lecture just yet. But what I've done with just this basic PHP syntax is I've taken what is otherwise a big text file that back in the day I would have had to parse myself, but simply by passing the name of that file to this constructor called simple XML element, it just returns to me the equivalent of a tree in memory that I can manipulate by way of these arrow operators and simply traverse them as follows. So what's going on now in this actual file? Well, if you scroll down, and I would invite you to take a close look at this at home if you find it of interest afterward. So I'm iterating over each lecture element. And for each lecture, what do I want to do? Well, I'm going to print out in bold the word lecture. And then next to that, I'm going to echo the current lecture's number attribute. So the way by which you get access to attributes that are in each of these lecture elements is just to index into the array. So this is why the picture looks kind of ugly. It's an associative array after associative array after associative array. So think of these things as multi-tiered hash tables. So if you want to get at the attribute called number, you don't do arrow number, because that suggests a child. Rather, you do bracket, quote unquote, number. So attributes, you use this bracket notation, which is an array notation. But if you want to dive deeper into the document, that is get the child that's beneath some element, you use the arrow notation, as we saw earlier, and we'll see again. So what are we doing in this first line? We're printing out lecture, followed by the number, followed by a raw colon, and then the title of that lecture. So notice again how I'm intermingling XHTML and PHP code here. Anytime I want to do something logically with PHP, just put it in the open bracket question mark and put your code there. And because I included, even though it's a little dark and purple, this curly brace here, everything that's beneath this line for the moment is conceptually inside of this loop, which means I have access now to everything beneath that line that I've highlighted to the current variable called $lecture. So just to be clear as to what's going on the web page over here, if I reload the page, notice that lecture, the number, a colon, followed by the title. Odds are I probably spit out a BR, yep, a line break right after that. Because what's supposed to come next? Well, the date is supposed to come next. How do I do that? Well, I just echo, actually ignore this line as a distraction for now. What I do is, where'd it go? Oh, no, I guess you can't do that. OK, so complicated fix for a problem here, but suffice. OK, so the date gets spit out there for various reasons because I want, oh, this is actually legacy. You know what? There are no hyphens in these dates. OK, the date gets spit out very simply on that second line. OK, so now what's going on? So now there's a bit more logic. And I think it'll get boring if we step through too much of this too closely. But this is just some basic use of conditions and loops here. So in the blinking line, I'm saying if the count of $lecture, arrow resources, arrow resource. All right, think back to what the XML file looked like. It was a lecture inside of which we said was a resources child, inside of which was what? Zero or more resource elements. So just by sort of following this, you know, cascade of arrow notation, lecture, arrow resource, means take the current lecture and begin iterating over any of its resource grandchildren each time, or rather, we're counting that because, again, these things all return arrays. So if there are more than zero resource elements, let's begin to print them because there's some work to be done here. Well, if there is a resource there, what do I actually want to do? Well, I want to iterate over each of those resources. So start at the current lecture, $lecture, go into its child called resources followed by resource, and iterate over each of those resource. So slides, demo, videos. Those were the resources in question. And what do I want to do for each resource? Well, for each resource, I want to print out its name, which recall was an attribute. Then I want to print out that colon. And now the code gets a little messy because I wanted to be anal and separate all of the various formats with these vertical bars. So I won't bore you with, I think, the tedium of how we achieved that and made it not have, for instance, the superfluous vertical bar at the end of the line, which sort of a lazy programmer might leave hanging. But if, for those of you coming from any programming, high-level programming background, this code should probably be pretty readable. Okay, and I'll sort of leave it at that because we'll make the code available. But the takeaway is just how we're able to very easily model this data with just a text file, call this constructor called simple XML element, and then I just sort of magically have access to all of this data as though it's just one big object in memory. And because this isn't a huge data file, you know, maybe it's a few kilobytes, even a megabyte would be pretty reasonable. It's a very reasonable choice for modeling your data. Unlike larger sites when you have to start storing lots of users, maybe lots of messages or credit card process transactions, when you actually want something higher performing, probably don't want to just use a text file, but it's a very useful approach to begin, say, the simplest of sites. Yeah?
In the for each statement, how deep can you get into the tree, like lecture, resource?
How deep can you get?
How many layers?
There's no limit. So because the XML file is fully extensible ad nauseum, the constructor will figure out the structure and present it to you in this way. So I'm going to fast forward for just a moment to this last slide to say that Project One is, as you may have seen, called Pizza ML, markup language. And to motivate the project, which ultimately is going to have you implementing a website with which your local favorite pizza joint can accept orders online. Well, we went ahead and decided to make this more real by ordering from the same menu. So you should find that there are 12 pizzas floating around the room. So let's go ahead and take a 5-7 minute break, and then we'll resume with some more PHP. We'll station them by the windows. right, so we are back. So one word about sections and the teaching fellows themselves. So we did, per my email this past week, settle on a section schedule that seems optimally consistent with folks' schedules and such. So we have three official sections, two of which are live and in person, one of which is purely virtual. Now that Project 1 will presumably, for many of you, be focusing on new things as opposed to old material like XHTML and do realize that the sections are meant to become very much a fundamental part of the course. We're certainly strongly urged to attend locally if you can. If not, Den and Cato's section on Thursdays will be filmed, and not only will it be streamed live, the video will also be put on the website by the next day or so if you'd like to tune in after. And Chris's section, recall, is purely virtual, and so Chris has been experimenting with some VoIP technologies. I believe we'll be building his own blog in upcoming virtual classroom settings as sort of a hands-on application that he'll build along with you over the course of the semester. So do feel free to tune in to one or more of those each week, depending on your schedules, especially as the project's material becomes less familiar to you. So just so that you, just if you'd like help visualizing what was otherwise a fairly cryptic-looking tree when we did the print R of the XML object, realize as an at-home exercise perhaps that here too might be a representative XML document, and I won't belabor what all these things are called, tags, elements, and the like, because we've seen that now before. But if you'd like to glance at that and then realize that when I said the XML is represented in memory effectively as a tree, well, one of the most common ways of viewing XML or XHTML is by way of a DOM, the document object model. And this is a topic we'll come back to in the JavaScript portion of the course. But for now, know that there is a translation of an XML fragment like this into something that is truly tree-like, where it's sort of a hybrid of a tree proper and also linked lists, whereby any element that might have one or more attributes can be thought of as being a node in this tree with a string of attributes laterally linked off to the side of it. But you can visualize that however you wish. So I offer this just as a sneak preview of where we'll be going and where XML will come back into the course. For now, Project 1 will be using it as a storage mechanism for data, a poor man's database, so to speak. In the future, though, we'll actually be treating your web pages as trees, as DOMs, because when we get to the AJAX portion of the course and you want to start automatically updating certain subsets of your site, what you'll typically be doing is actually traversing in memory using JavaScript the tree, the DOM that is your web page, finding the node in the tree where you'd like to update some content and inserting a new branch, so to speak, with some newly obtained data. So more on that to come. For now, treat this just as a visual as to how you can think of XML as being tree-like in nature. Here's the link to the simple XML API. Do take a look, certainly, at the example index.php file for the lectures page that I'll post after class tonight. But there are many more examples online there. And again, Googling simple XML PHP will also give you many more examples. Because Project 1, to be clear, and we'll finish off with this discussion tonight, we'll finish off with that topic later tonight, we'll have you modeling 3ACES menu in some XML format of your choice so that you can, again, implement those folks a website. But one other teaser, something that will prove useful not just for Project 1, but in general, whether you use XML in the context of this course or really in other contexts, a wonderfully useful query language for XML is something known as XPath. So in the previous example, I was just iterating over all of the elements in my XML document from first to last. And that is perfect for a page like the lectures page, which chronologically goes from first lecture to last lecture. There's really no searching that needs to go on. I don't need to look for data. I'm just iterating over data, top to bottom, spitting it out. That's probably not the ideal approach if you want to take something like 3ACES menu, the last page of Project 1, and represent it in an XML document. But then if you want the user to be able to add things to their so-called shopping cart before they check out from this website, if you want to be able to update quantities and such, you probably don't want to have to figure out the price of a calzone by starting top of the XML file and searching the whole darn thing until you see calzone somewhere buried in the middle of the page every time the user wants to update just one element. Better would be is if you could execute some kind of query, those of you with a database background, like a SQL-like query that says, here's my data, that is that XML object, go get me this data. rather than you having to reinvent this wheel known as searching and actually just look exhaustively for that piece of data. So an XPath expression or an XPath query is ultimately comprised of what's called a location path. And much like we use paths on file systems, C:\whatever, so does XPath use /something/something to go from one level to another in an XML document. So in PHP, we saw those arrows, which conceptually were diving deeper and deeper and deeper into a document. With XPath, you use slashes, just like you would on a Linux or a Windows machine. All right, so what is a in this world of XPath, and think of this as the query language for, or let's see, SAT terms, XPath is to XML as SQL is to a relational database. That's sort of the analogy here. So a location path is comprised of zero or more steps, where, as the name implies, each step lets you dive deeper and deeper into the document. And there's a bunch of different axes, but we won't dwell on those because for our purposes for Project 1, really the only axis that's going to be particularly useful is the child axis. Just go dive deeper and deeper and deeper, but know that there are others. So if I say /child:\, and then the name of the element I want to dive into, slash the name of the next element I want to dive into, slash, and so forth, what this query will give me is not all necessarily of the, say, resource elements in the document, but only those that are, won't give me all of the lecture elements in the document, for instance, but will give me the one that happens to have a number of 3 or a title of PHP. And by that, I mean the following. Let me go back to lectures, our lectures page, and butcher it slightly more for just a moment. Let me print out this pre-tag again, since I reverted to our original version of this a moment ago. And again, if I just print out this whole thing, print out XML, and then exit, and then display our lectures page, well, we're going to see that whole document. And that's way too much data. Suppose that at this point in the story, all I care about is getting the lecture that was called PHP. I don't remember what number the lecture was, so I want to search this XML document effectively for a specific string. Well, you can use the XPath function as follows. I'm going to print out not the XML itself, but rather the return value of calling the XPath function, which just looks like this and takes a string inside of quotes. So I want to get actually child:\lectures/child:\lecture. And now what I need is what's called a predicate. So a predicate is like a test that you can perform, a filter, so to speak. So what did this XML document look like? Well, remember that the XML itself looked like this. So a lectures, lecture, and then it's the title that I apparently care about, because I want to search for the lecture whose title is PHP. OK, so I'm going to go back to my XPath expression here. And what I will see once Vim responds, awkward pause, come on. Let's try that again. All right. So what I want to get at is not the whole lecture, but rather the one whose title equals quote unquote PHP. Okay, so a little cryptic the syntax, but again, I took a step in the document, I took another step, and now I'm filtering by the title, the lecture whose title equals quote unquote PHP. And there's no equals equals, it's just equals, complicating things still. Let's go back to the page and, aha, it was a quick change, but I reloaded the page and now notice that I indeed have the object that is storing only the lecture about PHP. I can actually search not just by child values, but I can search by attributes. So what's an attribute that a lecture has? Do you recall? A number. So I can actually say, and I'm doing this intentionally verbosely, and then I'll very quickly show you how you can make this all look prettier, attribute:\number=(1). Okay, this should, in theory, return the exact same lecture, yes? And it does. I reloaded the page. Nothing seemed to change because it's returning the same thing. Now, fortunately, This would not be a particularly fun language to learn. Attribute can be abbreviated with the at sign. Child colon colon can be abbreviated with nothing. So now much more reasonable is this XPath query, which is sort of optimized for the common case of just searching for children and attributes in an XML document. So now with that query, can I select the same element with far fewer keystrokes and arguably much greater clarity reading the actual code. So what this XPath function allows me to do is to search an XML document without my having to do one huge for each and then do a lot of if title equals equals foo, else if title equals equals bar, and so forth. I can just pull out the element that I want. And you'll hopefully see the applicability of this trick when, again, it comes time to represent for project one a menu like this, where presumably you're going to want to, once someone has added, say, a pizza and a calzone to their shopping cart, so to speak, if they want to then update the quantity, well, presumably you're going to need to find the price of the element in the document. And you might want to dive in deeper and say, you know what, give me the food item called calzone and pull back its price from some attribute or from some child so that you can update the shopping cart accordingly. The alternative, of course, is again one huge for loop or while loop searching the whole XML document just looking for one piece of data. Right? Why reinvent that wheel when others have come up with very neat APIs that are increasingly popular, mind you, not in PHP, but in general with XML? Yeah? Oh, excellent question. What's the return type? It returns an array. So it returns an array of all of the elements tags, so to speak, that match that particular expression. So in fact, I was using it as a search feature. Really, if I just did, just to show some magic here, this expression here, to be clear, is the same as just using the simple API itself saying, start at the root of the XML document and give me all of the lecture elements. So that this blinking line is really what I was doing previously. Now I'm doing something that, granted, is a little longer to type, but more versatile in that I can perform filtration of the results. But XPath, the function, does in fact return an array. Yes?
What if you want to return just the resources by the parent? So instead of returning the whole lecture in an array, you just want to return the resources.
Okay, excellent question, actually. So, and a good segue to one other example here. So suppose that I do want to get back, I want to filter out all the lectures except the guy whose number attribute equals one. But then from that point, I want to dive a bit deeper. So I filtered out all of the lecture elements except for that one. So if I want to now get all of the resource elements, I can say resources, resource. And you can just continue to step, so to speak, through the document, performing any number of predicates along the way, if you would like.
So that wouldn't include the title, for instance, of lectures.
Good. So no, this would not return the title. This, in fact, would only return an array of resource elements. So if you wanted to get back the title as well, you'd have to do it with a very different query. That would return resources. We'd have to roll back, say, to here, and say title, if I wanted to get back the title of lecture number one. Okay, and I realize that we're throwing a bunch at you tonight, but again, the point of at least our focus on this stuff in lecture is to introduce some of the basic building blocks, the concepts, and to really leave it to sections and very much the project to explore this kind of stuff with hopefully these so-called tools in your toolkits. Okay, so now back to the real world. Oh, not yet. Not the real world just yet. So we will see more of this throughout the semester, but those of you who've come from a programming background with an object-oriented language like C++ or C# or Java are familiar with the notion of objects and classes. And I used the word constructor before, simple XML element. What we've been printing recursively with that printr call is some kind of object, specifically a simple XML element objects. And that's why there's so much stuff inside of that object. There's a lot of data members. There's a lot of arrays as data members inside of that. If you'd like to read up on PHP's object-oriented programming features, this would be the recommended place to start. You don't really need to appreciate all of this stuff for the first project, because if you at least get a little comfy with XPath and just XML itself, that's plenty fine for project one's purposes. But realize as time proceeds, we'll likely see more and more of PHP's object-oriented features, though it's not necessary, say, to use classes and the like this first project, unless you wait.
The previous screen, if I may, the
The code?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you said that the xplot function returns an associative array, and in that line, actually, the title of the
It returns an array, not an associative array. Just to be clear, if that heads off the question.
So that line actually returns a title, correct?
That returns an array of titles, which contains just one title. It's an array of size 1 because there's only one title, because there's only one lecture in that node set, so to speak. Sure. OK, so back to the real world, so to speak, where we actually apply this stuff. So one of the new things we introduced on the course's website is this authentication module. And to be clear, you don't need to require that customers log in and out to your 3Aces website, as you'll see. But as time passes, and certainly a very reasonable real world feature for most websites is an ability to authenticate. So how might we go about requiring authentication for a website, but more importantly now, how can we have a form like this one submit not to some separate register.php file and then maybe redirect to some error page, but rather how can we keep things self-contained? How can we have this page submit, say, to itself so that, one, we can auto-fill these fields if maybe just the password was incorrect. It's kind of nice when websites fill in the username again for you, so you don't have to retype that. It's kind of nice if the error message that the user sees is on the same page so that they don't have to hit the back button or they don't have to go to some separate page altogether. So this is, of course, the page, if you've logged into the website in the past couple of days, that you see any time you try to access a restricted resource, like the forums, for instance. So if I go ahead and try to access the forums, notice that I'm automatically redirected to this page here. So how I did that redirection we'll tease apart in just a bit. But for now, assume that I've just visited this login page. It's at that URL, so /login. And let me strip off the trailing information so we can focus just on the intro, the basic stuff for now. So this is just an XHTML form with two fields, one text, one password, and one submit button. Let's take a look at where it's submitting to. So I'm going to go into the courses. Let's change this for our distant students who might need the websites. OK. Let's go into the login page. And notice there's just one file that does all of the authentication for the site. How's it working? And it's actually not all that long. So the very first line, just because of the way we've structured the course's website, is to include course.php, which again has a bunch of helper functions that I always want access to, database stuff and the like. So the first thing I'm doing appears to be executing PHP. So wait a minute. Let me scroll down, because yes, there is in fact XHTML in this file. Notice this function call, course begin, prints out the top of the web page, course end, prints out the bottom of the web page. So here really are the contents of this web page. Here's the beginning of the form. The action goes to where? Well, I could have, in this file, actually hard-coded index.php. But there's something to be said for a bit of flexibility. It turns out that PHP provides you not only with $get and $post, but also with $server, which provides you with access to a lot of environment variables, so to speak. One of which is the name of the current file. So this will let me do what primarily? Submit back to myself, first and foremost. And it allows me to do what file system-wise? So I could certainly use this form element on any page, and it will just work because I don't need to hard code the file name. But better yet, if I ever change the name of the file, the thing still works, right? So it's just a little trick that can certainly be useful. Let me roll back to what it actually was. So again, notice, to be clear, this intermingling of XHTML with PHP. I want to put inside of the quotes for the action line some PHP variable. Well, that PHP variable is an associative array called server. And it's the PHP self key that I want. In fact, just to make this more valuable, let's actually, again, use my little quick and dirty trick of printing a pre-formatted tag up top, and then print recursively the contents of the underscore server variable, and then just exit. All right, so this is, again, sort of quick and dirty technique. I've completely broken the website, or at least the login. But now you can see, and hopefully I'm not leaking, say, our database password. No, but I'm not going to scroll, lest it be there and bite me. So this, again, is just the $_server variable. And there's actually a lot of useful stuff in there. So one of them is what port we're currently on, which can be useful. I'm actually on an SSL connection right now. Request URI is one of the most useful ones that you have access to in here, because that tells you the path that the user has visited, which can be wonderfully useful if you want to do pattern matching or figure out exactly where you are within the script. We'll see examples of that over the time. The IP address of the user, the client port number. What else might be interesting here? What was the one we were using? Called script, what was it called?
PHP self,
which is down here, which is telling me the exact path to that file. So long story short, take a look in here. If you're ever sort of faced with a problem that you think might be solved by knowing something about the environment in which the script is executing, and you can print out the server variable to poke around and see what's inside of there. And we'll see our use of this over time. So, yeah?
Wouldn't you rather go to the one that you pointed out before, which is actually what the URL is? I don't know. I don't remember what it was now. So just /login/ instead of...
Oh, the request URI. Yes, I could have just posted back to the request URI, but the request URI actually includes the question mark and variables after it, which I sometimes don't want. And aesthetically, I don't really care if the file name actually appears. But sure, there are often multiple variables that are related in there. So here by default is the page that's being outputted. And we'll see in a moment why none of the PHP is really doing anything when I first pull up the page, but is only kicking in when we actually do a form submission. So this XHTML is what you see when you visit this page. But now, rather than submit to a different file, again, to be clear, I'm having the action of this form be myself. So that I have to do now sort of some controller logic, so to speak, at the top of the file. So at the very top of the file, notice that one thing I'm doing, which is a lesson I learned a few moments ago, is why don't I trim the username, right? Because it's kind of annoying to yell at the user for an invalid login if all he did was put a space after Malin, right? If we can, with one line of code, avoid that case, let's fix it. So I trim white space from before and after the username. Probably don't want to do that on the password just for principle, but you can argue that if you wish. Now I'm doing this decode URL thing for a neat trick that we'll come back to over time. One of the neat tricks that we've implemented is if you click on the forum, I hate this about websites, if you click a link for which you need to log in, and I think MySpace, for instance, does this, where I don't really have a profile, so you don't need to look for it. But if you click a link and then it says, no, you must be logged in to see that, and then you log in, you get redirected to the login screen, you type in your username and password, I think they just punt you back to their homepage, not to where you were trying to go. Not that hard to send the user where he was trying to get to, and this RA, return address variable, is just the trick I used so that we remember where you were trying to go, so that if you're trying to email a friend like a forum post, the URL of a post for the forum, yes, they might be prompted to log in, but then they'll be whisked away to that URL, so they don't have to go paste it in again. But for now, we can turn a blind eye, and what I decided to do was check if the length of the username does not equal 0 after it's been trimmed, and the length, and here I got lazy apparently, and the length of the password is not 0, then what I'm going to do is try to authenticate the user. But suppose that neither of those variables exist. Then that if condition is going to evaluate to false, which means none of this code gets executed, which means what happens? You just see the XHTML. So that's how I've embedded this controller logic, so to speak, at the top of the file, but everything just falls through if two conditions aren't met. So this is a way, as before with the Frosh onion thing, you can sort of infer, has the user submitted data or have they not? Because if there's nothing in post or if there's nothing in the post variable's username or password field, well then let's just show them the page, because presumably they didn't even try logging in yet. Ah, so about to get there. So suppose though they did provide a username and they did provide a password, we want to authenticate them. Now, we didn't think it would be all that nice of us to give you yet another username and password for this course, this one just for the website, right? We have full control over CS75.net, so it seemed kind of obvious, why don't we let them use that shell account to log into the website too? Now, there are different ways we could have done this. There's a module called PAM that we could have incorporated into PHP. But a neat trick that Harvard actually used to use on its computers in the labs years ago to require authentication, albeit using POP, not IMAP, is we have a mail server running on the local CS75.net .NET box, which accepts by design usernames and passwords and only lets me in if the username and password are correct. So sort of as a frankly reasonable hack, certainly for only 160 users, all we do to authenticate you is we check your username and password against the IMAP daemon on the local machine. Because if the IMAP server, the mail server, says, yeah, that's a valid username and password, we just close the connection and we assume that you've authenticated successfully. Now, there are other ways to do this. Frankly, I like the appeal of one line of code that let me get this done, you know, in 2 minutes one night. Okay, and for our user base, there's really no performance issues with the mail server. So, but our clever trick. How now do we as a website remember that a user has logged in? Well, one of the most powerful features of PHP out of the box is that you have access to this other super global variable called $_session. So the session variable is an associative array, a hash table, that you can store anything you want in, an object, a string, a number, and you can just store it there by a key. So if I want to store, say, a chunk of XML, and I want to call that XML foo, I can store, using a key foo, this value, which is the XML object, in this array. So it's much like a Java hash map, for instance. All right, so how do I do that? Well, I have to have access to $_session. I'm going to define a key called username. That is, I'm going to index into this associative array using this key. And what am I apparently storing in this super global called session? The username. So this is a very common approach and a very simple approach to just remember across page visits if someone has logged in. Because the magic of session is that unlike get or post, which only exist for that current page request, the session variable lives in memory for as long as the user's browser window stays open. So if I want to remember that a user has already given us a correct username and password, I can just tuck a little reminder to myself, like their actual username, in this super global variable, so that if on subsequent page loads, like if you try next to visit the forum, all I need is a line of code at the top of the forum code that says, if there's no username in the session array, deny access to this page. And we just have to check for the presence of that variable. And we'll come in a moment to how sessions are actually implemented, but this is what allows you to maintain state, so to speak, across what's otherwise, HTTP, a stateless protocol, whereby when you request a web page, remember our story, the web request comes in, the response goes out, and bam, the socket typically closes. That's not good if you want to remember something about the user. So this variable session creates the illusion for you, the developer, that you can remember something about this user, even if they take a minute or 2 minutes to click the next link. Yeah?
But if that window goes off-site, then you lose the session.
Typically not off-site. The user can often navigate to something like CNN, then come back N minutes later, and the browser will typically have remembered what's actually a cookie for that page. It's only when you kill the process.
It'll remember the cookie because you did the set cookie, or it'll remember...
Because someone, not me, but yes, PHP itself did a set cookie line. Yes. Yeah?
I correct me if I'm wrong, but I think this will allow someone to just make a cookie that has a valid username.
Ah. So an excellent question, and we'll actually come to this in a moment, but underneath the hood, these things called cookies are being used to implement sessions. But the username is not being stored in the cookie. A really big random number is being stored in the cookie. So yes, they could fake that, but with very low probability, which is frankly how almost all websites do this these days. OK, so this though, and actually, I see. Your point, you're alluding to this set cookie line. Let me actually delete this for a moment and focus just on this. So now these last two lines in login.php are just saying if a return address was given, that is a variable called RA with some value, you know what? Go ahead and redirect the user to that return address. Otherwise, redirect them to the home page. If they just didn't come from somewhere, they just pulled up the, if they just clicked the login link at the top of the page. But there's this one gotcha. Like what if I'm on the login page, and so my return address, so to speak, should be the login page, but I try to log in. Well, where should the login page send me if I originated at the login page?
Of course.
Well, back to the, well, if I start at the login page and I try to log in, in spirit, the purpose of this return address is to remember where I was, where I was, which was the login page. So I try to log in. This thing validates my, authenticates me, then says, all right, they were at the login page. Let's send them back to the login page. That's bad. Right, so this check here, preg match, using a regular expression again, is doing this trick because I know the structure of my website. If the return address happens to begin with /log for login and log out, what I'm not going to do is redirect them here. I'm going to instead redirect them here. So I could have avoided this by just never putting an RA value that refers to the login page, but I had to handle this case somewhere, either here at the last minute or when I actually generate these RA addresses, which I'm not going to, we'll show you in a second how we did this. How did we do this? Well, how did we do this? Where did it come from? Course authorize. Ah, yes. Where did it come from? Okay. So in the core, let's see, which page requires a login? So right now the form is the only part of the website that requires you to log in. So we added, we downloaded, as Project One explains, a software called Forum, P-H-O-R-U-M. We installed it in the course's account, and then we went in and hacked around with some of the code so that we could use our authentication module instead of their own. So you didn't have to, again, create yet another username and password. So we added a function call to essentially the top of one of that product's source code files called, not apologize, Corf Authorize, which is a function that we wrote in that file, in one of our helper files, that simply does this. So in other words, anytime you try to visit the forum, either directly or from a link that someone emailed you, what happens is course authorize is executed, and notice what it does. So if the variable called session bracket username is not set, that is, there's nothing there, what's the logical implication? The user is not logged in, so where should we send him or her? To the login page. So I call this function called course redirect, which is a function I wrote and actually adapted from PHP.net for the recommended way to do HTTP redirects. I'm going to send the user, yes, to the login page, but you know what? I want to do better than MySpace and remember where this user came from. And so what I want to do is append to the login URL $RA for return address, arbitrarily chosen, equals what? Well, here's a trick for using that server superglobal. I'm going to append, using the dot operator, the variable called request URI, which is this clever way of telling PHP, where is the user now? OK, grab that value, encode it with this function called URL encode, which does that funky thing where like spaces become pluses and or some spaces become percent two zeros so that it's just a string and it won't get bad things won't happen by not encoding it, and I append it to that URL. So how is this behaving for me ultimately? Well, if I go over to the course's website, just to the homepage, and now I click forum, notice that the URL is actually cs75.net/forum.ph. But per my comments earlier, when I click this, I'm immediately redirected, it seems, again, it's small, but to login/RA=. Something. Well, what is that something? It's just the funky encoded version of the path that I tried to visit, which was /forum, which again is just this neat way of really remembering state and passing state from one file to another. And I actually could have tucked that away in the session, but it's arguably a little more elegant to just tuck that particular datum in the URL like that. So long story short, it's that little trick, appending the previous URL to the URL that we're sending you to authenticate, that allows me to redirect the user to wherever they came from. The alternative, again, to be clear, is that if one of you emailed a friend in the class, hey, look at this brilliant bulletin forum post that someone just made that's really helpful, they click that link, the website realizes, username in the session is not set, let's redirect them to the login page. You log in, you get redirected to the home page, great, you're logged in, but damn, what was the point of this section? Oh, right, to go to the forum. So then you go to your email, like with MySpace, and paste the URL into the browser again, completely inane. And it's not hard to fix with a bit of programming chops. All right, any questions on this basic idea of login? Yeah?
I seem to remember in the earlier days of this type of if the browser or the user had cookies turned off, but it would work. You kind of had to program something along the complications.
So that's an excellent question, and let me summarize with what if the user has cookies turned off. So the nice thing about environments like PHP is that they out of the box try to deal with situations like that without you having to roll that fix yourself. So I just pulled up Firefox and my little sniffer here to show you that what's happening if I visit our website, and I'm just going to reload the home page. What I have here is a whole bunch of stuff that just went across the wire, but notice that, and let me see if I can find it. Yeah. So notice that the request I just made was, oh, you know what? I need to close Firefox first and reopen it so we get a new, okay. Damn, our homepage is the course's homepage. So what is happening, and I'm going to fake this. No, I shouldn't fake it. How do we change Firefox here? Home page. Show a blank page. Okay. No fake demos tonight. Okay, I'm in a new browser window, a new process. I'm going to open up my little sniffer, the plugin. Now I'm going to go to cs75.net, enter. Notice now if I look at the what happened, this was the request that went across the wire. Oh, it's still set. Thank you. Yeah. Okay, let's try one last time and then I'll fake the demo. Okay. Wonderful. Later. Okay, what a great demo. Okay, so I've got my sniffer open, my new browser, cs75.net, and let's see if I need to. Good, okay. So here's the HTTP request that went across. Very boring. Give me slash. Okay, and there's some other headers. Now look at the response from the server. It's a 200, which is good, we learned last week. But notice also that someone, not me, someone is setting a cookie. So the means by which a cookie is sent, which is typically just a bunch of different values, name value pairs, is the server responds with an HTTP header. Not a location header, not a MIME type header, but rather a set cookie header that has the name of the cookie you want to set and the value of that cookie. Now, as you can sort of infer, looks like one heck of a random number. And so what PHP does actually, and I'll jump ahead here, in order to provide the illusion of this super global called session, is that unbeknownst to you, or at least most users, is that as you click from page to page to page, even if you twiddle your thumbs for a while in between page loads, the browser, on every subsequent request, is sending back to the web server that super big random number that was set via the very first request. So this HTTP response, the very first from the server, is telling the browser, set this cookie, and any time you ask me for anything for the next n minutes or n hours, send back that value. Not with set cookie, but with cookie. In fact, let's look at some of the recursive calls, like here for the favorite icon thing. So notice that it's going to be a .. Let's see. Okay. Well, take it on faith that this .. There. Wait. Am I about to fess up to it? There. Oh, there it is. Good. So notice that on the subsequent request, I just scroll down to the next request, which is for that stupid little icon that browsers like to show in the address bar. Notice that the browser took it upon itself to include this line, which is that same number that it was passed. So this is how, again, sort of unbeknownst to the user, there's this sort of whispering going on from browser to server on every page request. And that big number tells the server, that is anything PHP driven on the site, when you want to give David the illusion of that super global variable, look up in a database effectively that big number and give me back all of the variables that that my code stored in session the last time the user visited a page. And it's actually not a database, it's a text file, usually in /temp. That's how sessions are usually implemented on an Apache box. So what's the point of, what was the point of all of this? Yes. So what if the browser doesn't accept cookies? What's nice about systems like Apache and PHP these days is if they realize that cookies are not set, are turned off, what the server will start trying to do is just appending PHP sesh ID, the name of that cookie and its value, to every URL that's going back and forth. So it's sort of a hack that nonetheless allows you to deal with the minority of users that just turn cookies flat off. But fortunately, that problem is, I would argue, kind of sort of going away, because just so many websites just don't function without JavaScript and cookies turned off these days. But PHP at least does a best effort to fix that. And if that doesn't work, then you're sort of SOL, and the site won't work for that user. Hand was going up? No? OK. So where? Let's see. see, you
post those pages.
Yes, I'll post all these files later tonight or by morning. So you kind of let me skip ahead here. So that was our intro to cookies there. And apparently it's not funny now, so it's just as well we didn't get to that. Let me do this. Let's take a look at one HT access issue, and then again, as promised, we'll conclude with a chat about Project One. So we mentioned that with HT access files, you can override some of the basic settings of a web server. Oh, here, there's an actual segue to this slide. It's not completely out of thin air. So one of the things we had to do for authentication, as a good service, was we wanted to require that any logins through the website were done over SSL, which is encrypted. So that's a good thing, but how do we enforce this, right? We can just certainly make that link at the top called login, go not to http://login, but HTTPS, but that wouldn't really stop a user from maybe just changing the URL, or maybe, it's just not good practice if there's a possible way for the user to interface with something that should be secure insecurely. Wouldn't it be nice if we could compel the browser to only pull up that page via SSL? And if the user tries to just use HTTP, just redirect them automatically. Well, herein lies the magic of Apache's mod rewrite module, which isn't always easy to pick up, but by way of examples is wonderfully useful to learn a few tricks with. So remember that we've configured the website much like any commercial website, poorly locked down commercial website, whereby you, the individual clients, users, can actually control a lot of the features of the web server by adding a text file called .htaccess in like your public HTML or any subdirectory, chmod it for so that it's readable by the web server, and then you can include directives such as these. What this is doing in our cs75.net public HTML directory is turning on what's called the rewrite engine, which just lets me do the following. And the first thing I do, and I left a little room for comments if you want to make a note to yourself, is the following. If the HTTP host does not equal cs75.net, and I did the backslash because it's a regular expression, recall from last time, case insensitive, where am I sending the user? To http://cs75.net/$1, which is just the contents of this regular expression, which just means where, however they reached us, make sure you redirect them to the canonical form of the URL, cs75.net. Because remember, there are many different names that DNS resolve to cs75.net, the most obvious being www.cs75.net. So that does not equal caret, which means start at the start of the string, cs75.net, but somehow I still got here to this HT access file, so let's redirect the user, which is indeed what happens in the browser. So it's those two lines that are forcing the user to stay on the non-www URLs, but here's what we're using now to ensure that SSL is used for the login pages. So if HTTP, let's skip ahead to this one, if the user request URI, that is the path that they have requested, is /login/. Okay, they're on the login page, and somehow they reach there, perhaps by HTTP only. And this variable, HTTPS, is not on. So they reach this, but HTTPS is not on. Where do I want to send them? To https://... So same idea, but enforces the use of SSL. By contrast, for performance reasons, we don't want you to stay on SSL for the rest of the site, because we don't really care if you're encrypting the PDFs going back and forth across the wire. In fact, it's just costing us CPU cycles unnecessarily to encrypt that stuff. So if HTTPS is on, and the request URI is anything other than a bunch of AJAX scripts we've written, or the and the login page, send them to the non-SSL version. So this too is a regular expression. If it matches AJAX or login, don't let them use SSL. If it doesn't equal AJAX or login, don't let them use SSL. Bounce them back. So that's sort of the opposite of this other one. Yeah?
The AJAX scripts that you're using is
ES? The AJAX scripts, we'll get to this in the future, but browsers don't like it if you have a SSL connection and you're trying to pull data from a non-SSL site because you potentially insert unencrypted data into your website. So this is how we enforce that the AJAX calls stay over SSL if they were initiated from an SSL page. But we'll come to that in time. Yeah.
Would the 301s preserve like the post request information, or would this break if I was trying to post to an HTTPS?
Good question. So this does break posts because the browser will at least complain if the server is trying to send you to another location with the posts. So, but that shouldn't see that symptom, assuming you designed your forms properly and weren't submitting to the wrong URL. And a user, granted, could manually induce that by hacking around, but it's immaterial anyway. So they'll get an error message. Well, they shouldn't have done that anyway. So how, just to give you a quick backdrop, we won't be using SSL much in this course, but we did turn it on for the site. At least heard to do this so that you can do it on your own site. It's really not all that hard to procure an SSL certificate. Actually, GoDaddy, to my knowledge, is among the cheapest and yet very well supported. $29.99 is what we paid for 12 months, and frankly, that's too much because the whole SSL scheme for typical websites is kind of frankly a joke these days. The fact that there's a market for these things when most users do not care who or what signed the so-called certificates. And if that doesn't make sense to you, that's fine. Any crypto class or crypto tutorial can sort of explain how SSL works. But realize that what we did, so that you can perhaps do this on your own at some point in the future, if you want to SSL protect your website, what you need to do is on, say, Apache or IIS or your web server, is generate what's called a CSR, a certificate signing request. And you usually do that by typing a bunch of commands, which you can find here via some tutorials there. Type a bunch of commands and you get back a text file. You then go to GoDaddy.com or the like, and you say, I want to buy an SSL cert. When they ask you for your CSR, you paste it in, you hit enter, and you pay them $29.99. They then mail you a certificate and one or more certificates, which you then need to install on your web server. And what you typically do on an Apache installation is in that file called http.conf, you specify an SSL certificate file, a key file, and maybe a chain file just by adding three lines of code to the web server and restarting it. So I offer this not so that you can do this very right away at home, because the catch with SSL, which is a nuisance, is that an SSL connect, if you have a virtual host, many websites running on one box, anyone who wants SSL needs a unique IP address, which is not ideal in a world of limited IP addresses where a lot of hosts charge for IP addresses. So our site on our box is SSL protected, but we do not have 268 IP addresses to give out this semester. So yours will not be SSL protected. Your own personal websites, like mailandrouge.com. But when you interface with our site, it is protected. So that's sort of an FYI to recreate these steps on your own box. So that brings us to sessions and Pizza ML. So the principle underlying this project one is to implement, again, a website with which your local pizza shop can start accepting orders online. And this is going to involve perusing their menu, deciding how to model that PDF as XML, or at least part of it. We do disclaim that unless you're really into it, you don't need to type out the entire menu and all of its options. A few from each category will suffice. But you'll model this data using XML, and then ultimately you will generate a site that allows the user to browse the various categories of food, add items to a shopping cart, so to speak, change quantities, update, add, and so forth, and then check out, so to speak. And when they check out, the user will be prompted for their name and, say, their delivery address and some other information as well. But underlying all of these interactions with the user is going to be error checking, ensuring that I can't buy negative 10 pizzas and then have you owe me money, for instance. That's not typically good. And you'll be making use of some of the things we looked at tonight. XML, quite likely XPath queries, quite likely this notion of a session. I mean, the way that most websites implement the notion of a shopping cart and remembrance of whether a user is logged in or not is by way of that notion of a session. So you should be able, in theory, then to tuck, for instance, the name or maybe the ID of a large pizza with sausage in that session variable so that as the user sort of considers what else he or she wants to add to the shopping cart, you on the server side continue to remember what they already put in the shopping cart. I mean, of course, you could just pass all this information around by just appending more and more information to, say, the URL that the user is following, but that is, there, say, a very inelegant solution, to be sure. So you'll use sessions for that. And so ultimately, by project's end, you will have the first of several dynamic websites, many of whose lessons will recur throughout the course. But without further ado, please help yourself to extra pizza, and we will see you in 2 weeks. Break next week.